All right, this one was requested by Scott Stouffle. He requested some Johnny Cash, so.
Gracious, let me tell you the news. My head's been wet with the midnight dew. I've been down on bending knee, talking to the men from Galilee. He spoke to me in a voice so sweet. I thought of the shuffle of angels' feet. He called my name and my heart stood still. When he said, John, go through my will.
When will you
will you realize piano waits for you? Good morning, Mr. Sun. The day's just begun. I've got so much to do now. I washed my hands this morning, so very clean and shine. Gotta hold them up to you now. Ooh. Let go, feet, be careful. Where you taking me to? Anything for that light shine, we love me too, but then again, don't mind, yeah. Who'd ever stop me from praising my God? Nobody. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, mercy, please. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yeah. O God, in thine anger, nor chasten me in thine own displeasure. Have mercy upon me, O God, for I am weak. O God, help me, for my bones are vexed. My soul is also so vexed. Though, O God, how long? Return, O God, deliver my soul. Save me from thy mercy's sake. For in death there is no remembrance of thee. And I pray you shall give me thanks. I am weary with my groaning. All my night make I my bed to sit in. I water my couch with my tears. My life is suffering grief and waxeth old because of all. Stop me from praising my God. Nobody. No man. Could ever stop me from praising my God. Good morning, Mr. Sun. The day has just begun. I've got so much to do. I washed my hands this morning, so very clean and shine. God, I hold them up to you now. I'll be home next year. I'll be coming home next year. Everything's all right up here. If I come down, I'll be coming home next year.
One more song. That's like perfect.
Perfect. You're good.
All right. This one's called Tim Shell. You guys may have heard this one before. We first heard this at a retreat that Steph planned, and then we played this at Wexford, and we had the join three churches together. So it's one of my favorites. Thank you.
we check this one? Hello, whoa, can you hear me? Yeah, plenty well, okay. Good evening. It is lovely to see all of you. Let me move this away for a minute. I'm so excited to see all of you guys, especially my young friends. It's good to have all of you guys here tonight. A couple things you'll need to gather. It's communion, so you should have something bread-like and something juice-like. If you don't have those things, we have juice, we have juice cups, and we have goldfish. So grab some of those. Also, later in the sermon, you'll need a note card and something to write with. I think I got all of you, but if not, they're up here on the ledge. Also, if I didn't give you a bulletin, they're also up here on the ledge. So anything you need, feel free to get up and go grab it. As far as announcements go, pretty much the same thing we normally say. There is worship on Sunday mornings, which is now 10 a.m. right here or on Facebook Live. It's also what we're doing right now, 7 p.m. on Wednesday nights. Music starts at 6:30 with Logan, as we just heard. Another round of applause for Logan. He'll take requests, so if you guys have requests after the service, let him know. The other thing that we've been announcing is we're doing a community art project that you sort of just saw get dropped off. Inside this door, during normal work hours throughout the week, this door will be unlocked. You can go in there. There's a canvas on the table. You're invited to decorate one of the leaves. We are keeping this here so that there aren't a million people flocking to it at once, but it's something you can show up at your leisure, fill it out, do it, and eventually it will be put together into one big awesome canvas. So throughout the next couple weeks, if you guys want to stop in the church and fill that out, that would be great. Any announcements from anyone else I'm not thinking of? Okay, I'm going to invite you all to stand where you are and spin around and wave at each other. Say hi.
Okay.
Okay. You guys are welcome to take your seats and then join me in the call to worship. I will read the normal parts and you all will read the bold parts. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their couches. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. May all God's people praise the Lord.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Oh, what you say I mean, I believe.
We are grateful that the Lord accepts and loves us for who we are, ready to receive us despite our wrongdoings. Let us turn to God now, first together and then silently. Please pray with me. Merciful God, you call us to turn away from behaviors and attitudes that belong to the darkness, to live honest and transparent lives as children of the light. We confess the times when we have failed, giving in to our darker thoughts and wants, and acting in ways that did not bring honor to your name. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us. Teach us how to live as children of the light. Amen. And now is a time I invite you into silent personal confession. My friends, hear the good news. There is no doubt that God is for us and not against us. We are the children of God, those born of a promise of God's salvation and peace. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for bringing us here together this evening, for the coolness of the shade that you have brought us, the music that you have brought us, and for our friends and family that are with us now. We ask that you quiet our minds, soften our hearts, and help us to hear the word you would have for us this evening. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, our Old Testament reading for this evening is Psalm 149. This is a fun psalm, as Ben said, because it talks about singing joy from your couches, which any other time in life we probably would have been confused by, but a lot of people might be joining us from their couches on Facebook Live, and you guys are in comfy chairs out here, so we can sort of live into the joy from their couches line. So listen now to the Word of God. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. Let Israel be glad in its maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy from their couches. Let the high praises of God be in their throats and two-edged swords in their hands, to execute vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples, to bind their kings with fetters and their nobles with chains of iron, to execute on them judgment decreed. This is glory for all of his faithful ones. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now our New Testament reading for this evening is taken from Romans 13, verses 8 to 14. Listen again for the word of God. Owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does not wrong, does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is fulfilling the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Will you come and follow me?
In youth and children's ministry, as these kids can attest to, we like to sum things up in clear and easy to remember phrases. We know that we lose the attention of you adults after about 8 minutes, and with children and youth, it is often far less time. So we try to be clear and quick and memorable. And no matter what lesson I'm teaching with the kids, it almost always comes back to this one thing: love God, love others. Every commandment from God, every lesson from Jesus is summed up in those four words: love God, love others. And the Ten Commandments, which Paul references in today's text, are summed up in one phrase: love God, love others. The first four commandments of the ten are about our relationship with God, and the final six are about our relationships with other people. If we truly love God and truly love others, then we won't break those commandments. Paul wrote this letter to the people of Rome to try to explain to them how they should best live together in a Christ-like way, something that even 2,000 years later, we have not figured out how to do much better than they had. He wanted to try to sum it up in a quick and easy to remember way so that when people weren't sure of how they should be living, they had something to remember. And so Paul puts it in slightly different terms than I do. Paul says, owe no one anything except to love them, for if you love others, you fulfill the law. The only debt we should have to one another is to be in debt to love them. Because if we love one another, then we'll follow the Ten Commandments regarding others. Because if you love your friend, you're not going to murder your friend. If you love them, then you won't steal from them. If you love someone, then you will rejoice in their abundance or rejoice in their happiness instead of being jealous of it. You will be happy for your neighbor who has a nice yard, or happy for your friend who bought a new dress, or happy for your friend in a relationship, or happy for your coworker's promotion. Because if you love these people, you will not covet what they have. And Paul is telling us all we should owe one another is love. And if we love God and we love others, we have fulfilled the law. Paul sums it all up when he says, love your neighbor as yourself. And the word neighbor in today's passage is interesting. I'm going to get geeky for a second. The Greek word here literally means another of a different kind. The word that we use for neighbor is another of a different kind. So in the original context, this may have meant to love one's neighbor in the widest possible terms, not just your fellow Christians, but your fellow humans. Paul is calling us to love one another no matter what lines we may draw between us and them, We are called to love fellow humans as we love ourselves, no matter how similar or different we may be. And although the divisions we draw may have changed some since Paul's time, our inclination to draw lines and to see people as us and them has not changed. It is much easier to write somebody off because of their views or their lifestyle than it is to accept them and to see them as a human created in the image of God and loved by God. Paul reminds us that we are called to love others of a different kind, and we know that is tough. But we often find that what we are called to do and what is right in the eyes of God is rarely easy. Because we know the things that we are called to not do. We already went over some of them. We shouldn't murder, we shouldn't steal, we shouldn't covet, we shouldn't lie. But simply not doing bad things is not the same as loving others. Just because I'm not murdering my friend doesn't mean that my friend feels particularly loved. We must therefore figure out ways to actively show love to each other instead of simply not being terrible to one another. And this can be difficult for us to do. We know that right now we are living in strange times. We just spent 6 weeks preaching through a series called Unraveled, where we talked about how things and people and plans and dreams have fallen apart during this time of pandemic. But the optimistic, faithful side of me wants to believe that this will also be a time of growth for us as people. I pray that we grow in self-awareness. I hope we become more aware of our priorities and the things and people that we treasure most. And I hope we grow closer as a community of believers who are striving to best love God and love others in whatever way we can. And one way that we can do this is to intentionally slow down. To slow down our bodies and our minds and be thoughtful with our words and actions. And in a few minutes, we will get to practice that through the sacrament of communion. We will again quiet our hearts and prayerfully consider Jesus' sacrificial love for us. But slowing down also means being intentional in our actions towards others. Many of us are functioning right now with less mental or emotional energy than we had before. So being aware of that, then how can we best show love to others with what energy and time we do have? How do you most crave that someone else will show you they care for you? In the early 1990s, a pastor and author named Gary Chapman came up with the concept of the five love languages. Have any of you heard of the five love languages? Perfect. Okay. Those five languages are words of affirmation, physical touch, quality time, acts of service, and gifts. And he argues that while everyone may enjoy each of the love languages to some degree, most people have one main language and one secondary language. These languages are how people best receive and experience love, platonic or romantic, from those around them. Some of you may have heard of these love languages and know yours already, but for others of you, this might be a new concept. So I'm going to quickly go through each of those love languages, and as I do, try to identify which one most clearly speaks to your heart. So the first one is words of affirmation. People with this as their love language are built up but also broken down by words. Words of affirmation are verbal encouragements, whether spoken or written, that uplift someone that you care about. They don't have to be lengthy or even particularly emotional, as long as they are genuine. Sometimes this is simply saying, "I appreciate you," to someone, or acknowledging that they are doing a good job. Sometimes it's telling your friend that they matter to you. Sometimes it's letting somebody know they made a difference in your life. Sometimes it's telling your child or grandchild that they did a great job on their painting, or telling your classmate that you like their new hair color. Any simple words of affirmation can go a long way, but also remember this means that hurtful or snide remarks may cut more deeply for these people if it's their love language. So if you care about someone with this love language, never doubt that they would benefit from hearing you say something kind to them, as long as you mean it. Number two is physical touch. People with this as their main love language feel connected to those they care about by being physically close to them. And this doesn't mean in a romantic sense. It's possible to show love to a friend or family member who has this love language. These are the people in your life who enjoy hugs and high fives, sitting near others, or silly handshakes. These people feel unloved without physical contact from those they care about, and even a pat on the back or a hug as you leave can give them that. You can give them all the words of affirmation you want, but it can't replace the importance of physical contact for them. So if you care about somebody with this as their main love language, remember that any amount of physical contact, though it might feel trivial to you, could make this person's day. Number three is gifts. People who have this as their main love language oftentimes are mislabeled as materialistic, but that's not really what's going on here. These are people who experience love and appreciation when you put thought and care into picking out a gift for them. This can be as simple as bringing them a cone of their favorite ice cream or a box of their favorite crayons. It doesn't have to be an expensive gift. Picking out this kind of gift, however small, proves to this person that you know them and you understand them and you care about them. Therefore, your love for them is shown by knowing what they would like, even if it's just their favorite ice cream flavor, their favorite pizza toppings, or their favorite coffee. If you care about someone with this love language, remember that the joy of gift isn't in its price tag, but in the small details you know about them. Two more. We've got quality time as number four. People who have quality time as their primary love language want to spend undistracted time together with the person they care about. This doesn't mean you can't watch TV or cook or play video games, but it means that they care that you are present with them physically and mentally. When they talk, you listen. These people don't really care what you do when you're together as long as you're spending time together. And because they care about that time spent together, it can be hard for them if you are distracted by things or if you cancel those plans. So if you care about someone with this love language, remember to try to spend undistracted time together. And the last one, for those of you counting, is acts of service. People who have this as their main love language really resonate with the phrase, actions speak louder than words. Acts of service means doing things for someone else, either things that they like or things that will help make their day easier. It might be bringing your friend dinner when they're staying up late studying, or maybe doing the dishes or laundry because you know that they are causing someone stress. It might be cooking a meal for someone you care about or filling up their gas tank in the car because you noticed it was low. Of course, these are things you do to show someone else you love them, not out of obligation or with resentful feelings in your heart. If you care about someone with this love language, remember to do something for them willingly with joy and love. So, acts of service, quality time, gifts, physical touch, and words of affirmation. These are the five ways you might receive and give love. And these are five ways that those you care about receive love too. As you leave here, I encourage you to talk to those you care about and figure out how they most need you to love them and seek to care for them in those ways. And we're going to practice one of them right now. On the ledge and also in your hands, you've been given a note card. There's also envelopes up here if you want to mail this eventually. I would like to invite each of you to write an affirmation to someone you care about. So we're writing nice, kind words to someone we care about. You're also welcome, if you're an adult, to pull out your phone and text someone or send them an email if that's more your speed. This is an invitation for you to take a minute to slow down and to be intentional and show love to your neighbor. We are called to be in debt to no one except to love them. So we must practice loving others and loving others well. I'll give you a few minutes to work on your affirmation and then we will conclude in prayer. So again, you're welcome to use this note card to write some sort of affirmation to someone you care about. And if you need envelopes at the end of the service, they're up on the ledge. you're welcome to keep working on it as we move through the service, but I'm going to close us in prayer. So please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for loving us. We know what we should not do, but it is often hard for us to figure out what we should do. But we know that when we are unsure, we should do well to remember to love you and to love one another as ourselves. Help us to live in such a way that we strive to love others as best we can, with your power and grace. Amen. If you will now go back to your bulletins and join me in affirming what we believe using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Okay, now is a time of the prayers of the people. So that means you as the people and you on Facebook Live, this is your time. So we want to share with each other as a community things that are going well in our life and that we want to praise God for, and things that we are nervous about or worried about and need prayer requests for. So I'm going to come out there, and if any of you have prayer requests or praises, let me know and I'll share them with everyone.
Anything to share?
Sorry, Facebook, we have two things to share, both praises, which is exciting. We had praise for an exciting startup of youth group last night. We took a group of like seven-ish middle schoolers and high schoolers to North Park. We had dinner together, and then we hiked around for close to 2 hours. They had a great time. We all had a great time. So we're excited to see what this year looks like, spending a lot of time exploring the outdoors with our youth. And then our other praise was for the community of Northmont, how well we have reached out to the neighborhood around us, how we are supporting each other, and doing the best we can to do ministry in this time and to love one another well. So that's great. Yes. Join me in prayer, please. Holy God, we are thankful that you are a God who wants to hear the good things going on in our life and the things that make us nervous. Even though you know them already, you just want to hear us speak them to you, so we thank you for that. We ask that you hear the praises that we had this evening, praises for ministries starting back up, for communities, for people who come together to love one another well, whether we are neighbors or we are people of a different kind. We thank you that all of us are here to rally around one another and to rally around those who surround us to love them well in a way that you would like us to. I also ask, as always, that you hear all of the unspoken prayer requests in our heart, the prayers of worry and concern about the future, about people we love, about people who are sick, all of those things that we don't want to talk about. We know that you hear them, and and that your Holy Spirit prays those things for us when we can't bring ourselves to say them. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. So now we'll enter into the sacrament of communion. If you'll join me in the call and response prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Friends, this is an exciting time where we get to do what I just talked about, where we once again try to quiet our thoughts, focus on right here and right now, and we soften our hearts to experience communion in a way that is different than any other time that we are eating goldfish or bread or waffles or juice, whatever you brought with you. This is a time that stands alone. This is different. Because we know that this is not our table, this is not my table, this is not Northmont's table, but this is Jesus's table. And this is a table of radical inclusion where everyone is invited to come to this table and take this meal. We know that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his friends in the upper room and he took a piece of bread and he broke it. He said, This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup and he poured it out and he said, This is the new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me. My friends, as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving life, death, and resurrection of Jesus until he comes again. My friends, all is ready. So I now invite you to take your bread, your breadish thing, and your juice, and partake. On Sunday, we asked anyone joining over Facebook Live to share with us whatever you're using for communion, and we got some exciting responses. So anyone who's watching now, let us know what strange household items you are using for communion. So we know that the Holy Spirit does some awesome things and can be present through all of these different elements and all of us who are scattered all over the place. Thanks, Tony. Okay, let me pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this meal, for bringing us around this table of mysterious and radical inclusion. We ask that you bless this meal, have it fill us up, not physically, but fill us with your spirit, with your grace, with your patience, and with your love, and help us to go out into our communities and our families and use that patience and love and show it to others as you would have us do. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
come sit at the table. Come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary. Blessed that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are, come as you are, all in his arms, come as you are. There's joy for the morning, a sinner.
It's a miracle I got out of that without tripping. Thanks. So this is a time of offering. For those of you who have already done it, that's great. You can come put your offering envelope in this table, on this table, anything like that, if you brought it in person. If you are joining us on the internet, there are ways to give electronically. You can check the Piper or contact us via email and we'll explain that to you. You can also use old-fashioned snail mail to mail it in. We're still accepting offering and envelopes through the mail. So let us have a prayer for our offering. Holy God, we know that all good things come from you. We ask that you bless the offering and our tithes of money and gifts, and that we use them towards your kingdom and the furtherance of the things you would have us do. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. My friends, Jesus understood our tendencies to draw lines between ourselves and others, our tendencies to create groups of us and them. And 2,000 years ago, Paul saw the same tendencies among Christians in Rome. So in order to give us an easy reminder, he told us to love our neighbors as ourselves. We are called to owe no one anything other than to love them. And although we all receive love in different ways, the important part is that we take time to slow down and to be intentional about showing love to one another, no matter how similar or different that person might seem. And we know that this is a tricky task, but luckily we do not do it alone. But we seek to love others with the presence and power and grace of the one who creates us and redeems us and sustains us now and forevermore. Amen. Okay, I'm gonna take the camera and spin it around. Get ready to wave to the people on the internet. Ready to wave? Say hi.
Hola.
Hi. Say hi.
Hola.
Hello. Hello. Coming to you guys over there. Have a good one, guys.